Channel. I'm about to discuss the protocol for suspected or confirmed case of mucormycosis. So clinical findings is very important. If a patient present with facial swelling, especially swelling of the eyes, headache which is especially unilateral, and if he has some nose blockage, and then he has some dental issues or some pus discharge, some gingival abscess or loose teeth, and then he has a background history of recent COVID and who have been treated with heavy dose of steroid or have been admitted in the hospital, and he might be having some underlying immunocompromised state, diabetes, renal failure, malignancy, etc., then you should strongly suspect mucormycosis. In all such cases, patient has to undergo some form of imaging, CT scan or MRI. The advantage of CT is that it gives very good bony details, but MRI score here in terms of telling which tissue is having contrast. So those tissue which have very good blood supply would take up the contrast. And the characteristic of mucormycosis is that wherever it infects, it's cut the blood supply of the tissue because of underlying thrombosis. So the thrombotic tissues will not take up the contrast and you can suspect fungus in that area. That's why with MRI with gadolinium enhancement, you better know which areas you have to debride. Along with routine blood tests, complete blood count, C-reactive protein, hemoglobin A1C and renal function test are necessary. With radiological finding like sinusitis, especially if it is close to the orbit wall, lamina papyracea, when it erodes the bone, then these are intermediate stage. And when both orbit and brain are involved, then this is a very aggressive this thing. So you have to define whether it's the early stage or it's a late stage. In the early stage, you can go for excisional biopsy, means during taking the biopsy only you can remove whole of the muck and you can debride sinus lining if it is suspected it's involved with the routine functional endoscopic sinus surgery. But well, when bony erosion is there, you can't just leave osteomyelitic bone there. You have to debride and curettage till healthy bone. And orbital exenteration is indicated, especially if your ophthalmologic leak feels so. And you, as a ENT surgeon, you will obviously perform functional endoscopic sinus surgery. Whatever tissues you get, you can send it for bacterial or fungal culture sensitivity. You may use frozen section on table. And later, histopathology report give you the final diagnosis. Once successful surgery is done, you have provided adequate ventilation and drainage. Then patient is taken for antifungal medication. Amphotericin is available in two form. One is this is routine amphotericin B. Other is a liposomal amphotericin which has less renal toxicity. The dose mentioned is here. You can see on the screen, which is given for 2 to 3 weeks. If you have done very good surgery, then only even 1 week of amphotericin is sufficient. And as a step down treatment in all the cases, especially during discharge, patient is put on Posaconazole, which is in tablet form. And the first day, usually it's given 300 mg twice daily, and then rest of the days is once daily 300 mg. You have to perform on liposomal or normal amphotericin B, routine kidney function tests, electrolytes. And you have to, there's a specially designed protocol for giving amphotericin. It means you have to rehydrate the patient and then you have to give mean amphotericin slowly. And then after that, you can supplement with normal saline, especially with one ampoule of potassium. And after discharge, regular follow-up is necessary in form of nasal endoscopy. And you can get a repeat CT scan, maybe 15 days to 1 month after. So, I hope you must have got insight into the protocol for managing mucormycosis in the hospital. Thank you.